Lead Together was formally released in the US on Soundgarden's greatest hits album, A-Sides. In 1997, this was the band's first release post-breakup. The song had, however, already previously been released as a B-side on some international editions of the Burden in My Hand single of the 1996 album Down on the Upside, as well as the Australasian tour bonus CD Down Under on the Upside. Originally recorded during those very sessions, Kim Mathias said that the record company wanted the song to appear on the album, while the band was unhappy with the mix they had received and scrapped it, though he did note that what ultimately got released was just one of many mixes available. It appeared again on the compilation Echo of Mild Scatter Tracks Across the Path many years later in 2014. There are two rhythm guitars that can be separated into the left and right channel each. They are often playing the same parts, but will stray in places. Playing together, doing the verses until the very end of the bar, where only the right channel keeps playing certain ornaments that are also going to differ between the verses. The endings of the pre-choruses too are different between the channels, and one of the bridge segments also has distinct parts. A third guitar is going to be the lead, which plays overlays during the intro, first pre-chorus, and both choruses. It also plays two solos, a short one during the interlude, and a long one during the bridge leading into the outro. The time signature is plain 4-4, and the tuning is plain standard, E, A, D, G, B, E. The drums open the song. A second later, both the left and right channel guitars come in, playing together. This starts on an E5 chord, for which we strum together the open low E and the second frets on the A and D strings. We let this ring out for a moment before strumming the next chord by adding in the first fret on the G string, which is an E variant. Next, we'll be plucking the third fret of the low E string to slide it up to the fifth. Then hammer on the fifth fret of the A to the seventh. Pluck the fourth fret on the D. And then play a C sharp 5 chord, strumming together the fourth fret on the A and the sixth frets on the D and G strings. After a slight moment, strum this again, and then play a C-sharp 7 sus, for which you can just lift, if you play this chord like I do, the ring and pinky fingers, to play just the 4 frets of the A, D, and G strings. If you play it like this, same principle, or like this, doesn't really matter. Then you're back to the C-sharp 5 for the next strum, C-sharp 7 sus, C-sharp 5. After a slight moment, C-sharp 5 again. After another slight moment, C-sharp 5 again. C-sharp 7 sus, C-sharp 5, C-sharp 7 sus. That's the first bar. The second one starts on an E5 again, and now immediately follows with four strums of this E variant we've learned in the first bar. Then one final strum of a full E major bar chord, for which we're going to be adding in the open B and high E strings as well. And from here on out, we're going to be repeating what we've learned in the first bar. That's the second bar, and finish with the intro. A If you're wondering about the strumming pattern, there's nothing said here between the two guitars. I indicated in my transcript when you maybe should be down and up strumming by slight pauses in the tab. But at the end of the day, anything that you play to make this fit is going to be fine. Could be playing it with a lot of downstrokes, that's not how I personally do it. I do, however, suggest that for the slick that is happening, that you don't separate the strings before moving to the chord, but rather try to play it as a fluid motion and then add in the chord to this. Because if you break this up, it becomes choppy and you are also slowing down your playing. Compare this. When you have to reposition your index finger rather than where it's fluid motion. Now that we've learned these two bars, let's combine them and play through them slowly. Time, a third guitar is playing, that being the lead. Which we begin with a unison band, for which we'll be plucking together the 19th fret on the G and the 17th fret on the B. The B is going to remain stationary while we bend up the G a whole step. And what happens when we do this is that it meets the pitch of the B. We then release the bend and without plucking, bend it up again and then slide it down the neck. Then we hear string noises of the fingers just being run across the neck without plucking a slide. Since this unison band is giving us two E notes, technically speaking that's a slash chord, an E slash E. Next, we'll be plucking the open B string. After a moment, the 16th fret on the G. Then the 18th fret on the B with vibrato, for which we wiggle the string back and forth. That we, after a moment, slide down the neck. And then again, we hear the string noises of the fingers being moved across the strings without plucking. That's the first bar for the lead. The second one starts by plucking the 6th fret on the G, followed by the 7th fret on the A, and then bend up the 9th fret on the G with a whole step and release it again. So you can see that we're trying to move the pitch of the 9th fret to that of the 11th and back down to the 9th. Thank you. At 11 seconds, with them being the first verse, we have a left and right channel played together, until the very end of the bar, where there's only the right channel. On a B5 chord, strumming together the 7th fret on the low E and the 9th fret on the A and D strings. After a slight moment, follow it with 5 more strums, before moving to an E5, which we move up one string at a time, so now we'll be playing the 7th frets on the A and the 9th frets on the D and G. Back to the B5 for 2 strums, then a muted strum of the A and D and G strings, before one more strum of the E5. Then we move this down 2 frets for a D5 that we strum 4 times. Then a G-sharp 5, which we slide up to an A5, starting on the 4 frets of the low E, with the 6 frets on the A and D strum together, slide it up 1 fret. Strum this A5 once more. Then slide up the E5 we've already learned up here, 1 fret to an F5. Strum it twice more. Full C major bar chord, which we move down one string at a time, strumming together the 8th fret on the low E, the 10th frets on the A and D, the 9th fret on the G, and the 8th frets on the B and high E string, twice. Now, only one of the guitars, the right channel, is playing an additional ornament at the end of the bar. Beginning on the 8th fret of a D, next hammering on the 9th fret of a G to the 10th and pulling it back off to the 9th, plucking the 10th fret on the D, the 8th, the 10th, the 8th, and then slightly sliding down the 10th fret on the G. Not far, because the next bar starts up here on the B5 again. So whether you would like to play this ornament while retaining the bar chord shape from the C major, or you would rather pluck this singularly, depends on what your hands can do better. The next bar is going to be repeating all of these shapes until the very end, where the ornament is going to differ. Now we'll start by hammering on the 9th fret of a G to the 10th and pulling it back off to the 9th, plucking the 8th fret on the D, the 10th, the 8th, and slide the 10th fret of the G down the neck lightly. Again, not too far, because the next segment is going to begin up the neck again. As far as the strumming is concerned, we are once again mixing, matching down and up strokes, however is most fluent. And speaking of that, as far as the fingering is concerned, if you do bar the chords like I do, this is going to be a really economy of movement friendly way to strum this, because we keep barring with the index finger and we're just moving the fingers between the strings. The same principle is if you are holding the chord like this. like this. At 26 seconds, we'll then be in the first pre-chorus, where both the left and right guitars are starting by playing the same thing again, up until the very end, where they will split once more. This is where the split happens. The right channel now continues, where the left channel instead plays. We begin this with two strums of the E5 that we've already learned up here. Then I'm just adjusting the fingers to play two strums of the B5 we've already learned. Repeat this once more. Two strums of the E5 followed by two strums of the B5. We need minimal movement here because we're going to be playing it really fast. And we'll be retaining these changes between chords throughout the rest of the bar. We're now moving this up to play an A5, therefore also for two strums, a 12th fret A and the 14th frets on the D and G strings. Adjust the fingers down to now play the 12 frets on the low E and the 14 frets on the A and D to play another fingering for the E5. Repeat. Now we'll be strumming a G5 twice. That's the 10th fret on the A and the 12 frets on the D and G string. And adjust the fingers to play a D5. So now the 10th frets on the low E and the 12 frets on the A and D strings. Twice. Repeat. Now we'll go back to this A5 that we've learned up here for two strums. And then move down for D5, strumming it once. And now adjust the fingers to play an A5 voicing we've already learned for one strum. That's the first bar. The second one starts by sliding a D-sharp 5 up to the E5. So that's going to be the 6th frets on the A and the 8th frets on the D and G. Slide it up one fret, and then repeat. Second bar, we're going to be plucking the 5th fret on the low E string to slide it up to the 8th and add in the 10 frets on the A and D strings to strum together the C5 chord ones. This being where clever two guitar split. The right channel is now going to keep strumming the C5 approximately 12 times. While the left channel instead is going to be plucking the 9th fret on the G. Pluck it again to hammer it onto the 10th. Pluck the 9th. Pluck the 9th again. And then the 10th. Then we're in the second verse, where the left and right channel are going to be repeating what we've learned for the first one. At the end, the right channel is, however, going to be playing a different ornament. So the chord structure here remains the same, but the ornament, we begin on the 8th fret of a low E string, followed by the 10th fret on the A, then hammering the 9th fret of the G onto the 10th and pulling it back off to the 9th, plucking the 8th fret on the D, followed by the 10th, followed by the 8th, and then lightly slide down the 10th fret on the G. That's the first bar. The second one is going to be an exact repetition of this one. So you can see this does not bear repeating. I'm not going to be slowing everything down to repeat it and demonstrate it once again. Instead, let's take a look, slow it down, at the stiffening ornament at the end of both bars. For both of them. Then we're in the next pre-chorus, which again is going to be a variation of the first one we've already learned, with the left and right channel playing together up until the very end where they split. Play something different this time. And the split is going to be occurring here, after the strum of a C major chord. The right channel is going to continue by playing. While cello is going to continue playing. So the right channel here is going to keep strumming the C5 voicing we've already learned approximately 12 times again. The 12th time being when we're side down to the A5 voicing we've already learned, strumming that approximately 9 times. Three plucks of the open low E string. No need to repeat what we've already learned for the first two bars in the pre-course, we went over that. Instead, let's take a look slowed down at the stiffening third bar. Simultaneously, the left channel is going to keep strumming the C major bar chord twice. Then strum it again, hammering on this 9th fret on the G to the 10th, for which we'll be using the pinky. And the chord shape this leaves us with, played on the 8th fret of the low E string, the 10th fret on the A, the 8th fret on the D, hammering the 9th fret on the G on effectively to the 10th here, still barring the 8 frets on the B and high E strings, is a C major 7th sus. After this, we'll be strumming the C major 4 times again. The 4th one is the one we're going to be sliding down. Which we know will be strumming approximately 12 times. Again, let's just slow down this final differing bar. At the same time, we again have a third guitar joining, being the lead again. For this, we strum together a slash chord, playing together the 11th fret on the D and G strings twice, giving us a C sharp slash F sharp, before plucking the 9th fret on the G, followed by the 9th fret on the B, and then the 11th fret on the G twice. Lastly, the 9th fret with vibrato, that we then slide down the neck and stop from ringing out. Seconds will then be in the first chorus. And you will hear that this is a variation of a segment we've already learned in the intro. Begin on the slow E5 voicing we've already learned down here. Two strums, followed by the full E major bar chord voicing, also for two strums. One strum of the E5, one strum of the E major. Then repeat the riff and chord structure we've already learned for the intro. Just playing this one C sharp 7 sus, we add in a second one at the end here. It's the first bar. The second one starts on this E variant, on the low E string, A, D, and G string for the chord, one strum. Followed by the full E major bar chord, one strum. And then the E variant for three strums. To a D5 shape we've already learned here. Pluck the 5th fret on the A string to hammer it onto the 7th and pull that back off to the 5th. Pluck the 7th fret on the low E string, followed by the 6th, followed by the 5th. And then play the C5 that we've already learned as well. Three strums. Now I'm lifting my ring and pinky finger. Same principle as before, you can see just on a different chord here, to play a C7 sus for one strum. Back to the C5. C7 sus. C5 for two strums. C7 sus. C5 and C7 sus that we start up the neck, because the next bar starts on the C5 again. And one word on the fingering here, the voicing. Now, we will never know for sure, considering there has been no live performance of the song whatsoever, and there probably never will be. Knowing Soundgarden and having transcribed a lot of their catalogue, I do believe, and this is also what I'm hearing on the recording with the thicker strings here, that they did in fact play it in the unergonomic fashion, like so often, up here with a 5 chord rather than the open chord, and then played the hammer-ons up here too, followed by the plucks, rather than here. Either way, after the second bar we'll be moving on to the third one. As noted, sliding up, we'll be on the C5 again, that we strum 5 times, and the 5th time is when we'll slide it down 2 frets to the D5. Which we'll now be strumming 7 times. The 7th time being when we slide it down 2 frets to the C5. Which we now strum 3 times. Then pluck the low open E string. And follow it by an F sharp 5 voicing we've already learned. Then strum it 4 times more. The 4th time being when we're slided up the neck, because we need to end up here again for the next bar. Now we're going to repeat playing the E5 and D5 as we've learned for the previous bar. Then strum the C5 once more. At lower volume, really hinted at as ghost notes, the C7 sus, followed by another C5. Then pluck the low open E string once and play this G5 voicing we've already learned approximately 9 times. And now move up here to quickly play for 2 strums as a doublet the G5 voicing we've already learned. just moving the fingers down, same position, to play a D variant. I'm a 10th fret on the low E string, the 12th frets on the A and D, and the 11th fret on the G. For one strum, ending this chorus. Doing the third bar of this, again, a third guitar joins, this being the lead. We're again playing a unison bend here, a C sharp, playing together the 4th fret on the G with the 2nd fret on the B. The B remains stationary, and the G gets bent up a whole step. Then we release this bend, and bend it back up again, plucking it together with the B 5 more times. Then we release the bend and hint at sliding it down the neck. Leading out of this, there's a short drum fill, which at 1 minute 31 seconds leads us into this little interlude, where only the right channel is going to be playing as the rhythm guitar. So for this, we are simply alternating between chord shapes we've already learned, starting with 2 strums of a C sharp.
5.
Followed by 1 of a C sharp 7th sus. Then 1 C sharp.
5.
Now 3 muted strokes of these A, D, and G strings. So we're not fretting anything, we're just trying to get the dead sound from these strings. 2 strums of a C sharp.
5.
1 of a C sharp 7th sus. 4 strums of a C sharp.
5.
1 of a C sharp 7 sus. 1 of a C sharp.
5.
2 muted strokes. 2 strums of a C sharp.
5.
1 of a C sharp 7 sus. 1 C sharp.
5.
1 C sharp 7 sus. second guitar, the lead, is going to play a small solo over this. This begins by plucking the 11th fret on the G with a whole bend. Release, bend up again without plucking, play with vibrato, repeat, repeat, and now pluck the 11th fret without any bend. Pluck the 9th with a half bend, and release. Quickly followed by plucking the 12th fret on the low E string, and the 9th. Now play a slash chord by strumming together the 9th frets on the D and G strings for B slash E. Now two strums of the C sharp slash F sharp that we've already learned on the 11th frets on the D and G. Quickly follow it by plucking the 12th fret on the low E string with a quarter bend. This is a very slight pitch increase, not even up to the next fret. Follow it by plucking the 9th fret on the A, the 9th fret on the D, the 11th twice, 9th fret A, 11th fret G, and the 9th with vibrato. 11th fret A, 9th fret G, the 11th fret that you bend up a half step, release, and play with vibrato. Let this ring out. Where the left and right channel again begin playing the same thing together. Then at the very end of a bar, only the right channel is going to be playing, and this time yet another ornament. So here, this first bar is not actually going to begin with a full strum of a B5, but just a pluck of a 7th fret of a low E string. Before then, resuming with a B5 chord, and the rest of the bar as we've already learned it. The ornament at the end, from the right channel, begins by plucking the 8th fret on the A. Then a strum of a C5. Pluck of a 10th fret of the A. Hammer the 9th fret of a G onto the 10th and pull that back off to the 9th. Pluck the 10th fret on the D, the 8th, the 10th, the 8th, and lightly slide down the 10th fret of a G down the neck. Then the ornament at the end of the second bar begins by plucking the 8th fret on the D, hammering the 9th fret of a G onto the 10th, pull that back off to the 9th, pluck the 10th fret on the D, then the 8th, the 10th, the 8th, and sliding down the 10th fret of a G string, the neck, lightly. First ornament and the a second ornament. Then we'll be in the next pre-chorus, where the left and right channel again are playing together, repeating the same thing we've learned for the second pre-chorus for the first two bars. The right channel then repeats its third bar, as we've learned, where the left channel plays a different variation of this third bar. So after the C major, the right channel then repeats as we've already learned, while the left channel at the same time plays. Here we begin with two strums of the C major bar chord. Then, as we've already learned for the second pre-chorus, use the pinky to hammer on the 9th fret of the G to the 10th, giving us the C major 7 sus chord. Back to strumming the C major 4 times. Now the C major 7 sus 1 strum without any hammer-ons, and slide this 10th fret down. Now we'll be playing a partial A, strumming together the 5th fret on the low E, the 7th frets on the A and D, the 6th fret on the G, and the 5th fret on the B twice. Then add in the pluck of the 5th fret of the high E string. Next, strum together the 6th fret on the G and the 5th fret on the B for an E/C# chord. You can see I'm keeping in bar chord position throughout. Then, two strums of the A major bar chord. And now lifting the pinky and placing it on the 7th fret of the G, leaving us with the 5th fret E, 7th fret A, 5th fret D, 7th fret G, 5th fret B, and 5th fret high E for an A7 sus. Is going to be a variation of the first one that we've learned, with only the ending segment differing. Both the left and right channels are going to be playing this together once more. So at the end of the final bar, we are not going to be strumming this G5 chord 8 times here, but just once, and then follow it with 5 strums of a partial A, adding into the shape the 4th fret on the G string. And the 5th strum is going to be the one that we slide up the neck. Guitar playing this lead overlay that we've already learned in the other chorus. At 2 minutes 28, we'll be entering the bridge segment, where the left and right channel are playing together. we begin on a partial C, for which we strum together the 8th fret on the low E, the 10th fret on the A and D, and the 9th fret on the G, approximately 8 times. Next, move the pinky to include the 10th fret on the G string, which leaves us with the 8th fret on the low E, 10th fret A, 8th fret D, and 10th fret G, for C7 sus, partial one. Slide this 10th fret down, because we'll next be playing the full A major bar chord, approximately 9 times. Then, move the pinky to play the A7 sus shape that we've already learned, strum this once, and slide the 7th fret up the neck slightly. Back to the partial C shape that we strum twice. Now hammer on the 9th fret of the G to the 10th, strumming this once for this partial C7 sus, before returning to the partial C, and then simply repeat what we've learned for the first bar. The bridge segment continues, however, this is where the two channels are going to be playing different parts. And they will do so playing only with light gain rather than the heavy distortion we've used throughout the rest of the song. Let's begin with the right channel, playing. This begins with one strum of the E5 chord that we've already learned up here, followed by two strums as a doublet of a D5, two strums of a C5 as a doublet, then a doublet again, however consisting of one strum of the F-sharp 5 and the other one of a full F-sharp major chord. We, after a moment, slide up the neck. That's the first bar. We'll be playing the E5 for one strum, the D5 for one strum, the C5 for one strum, and now a partial F sharp that we've already learned on the E, A, D, and G strings. Which we, after a moment, slide up the neck. That's the second bar. The third one is going to be an exact repetition of this one. And then for the fourth one, we begin with one strum of the E5, a doublet on the D5, a doublet on the C5, and a doublet on this partial F sharp, which we after a moment slide up the neck. Same time, the left channel is going to be playing, also with light gain. All we're doing here is playing the 7th fret of the A string with alternate picking. This is not fast enough to be tremolo, which is played rapidly. We're simply just following every downstroke with an upstroke. To fit what the right channel is playing, I've notated this in my transcript as 4 bars of 16 plucks each. And since we are alternate picking, keep in mind that one pluck consists of one downstroke followed by one upstroke. So it's 32 plucks actually. We'll be playing this. That's one pluck. Repeat 15 times. This bridge segment further continues, however, now both the left and right channels are going to be playing the same thing again, and they do so using heavy distortion once more. Here with this E5 voicing, we've already learned strumming it approximately 5 times. Then the D5 approximately 5 times. The C5 approximately 5 times. And then this partial F sharp on the E, A, D, and G strings approximately 7 times. And the 7th time that we slide up the neck. That's the first bar, which we're going to be repeating 7 times now. At the end, we'll be adding in 2 chords we've already learned, the G5, followed by the D5, which we let ring out as the song fades out. Guitar joins the lead again, playing a longer solo this time. This begins by hammering the 14th fret of the G onto the 16th. Followed by plucking the 15th fret on the B with the whole band. Pluck the 12th. Pluck it again to hammer it onto the 15th. Pull it back off to the 12th. Then pluck the 14th fret on the G. Repeat this shape, hammering the B string on, pulling back off, and plucking the G string 6 times. Then pluck the 12th fret on the B, followed by the 14th fret on the A, twice. Play the 15th fret on the B with a half bend, release it, pluck the 12th fret. Then the 14th fret on the G, 11th, 14th, 9th, 11th, and hammer the 9th fret onto the 11th. Play the 10th fret on the B with a whole bend. Pluck the 12th. So we're bending it up to that pitch and then following it with the note fretted. Hammer the 10th fret onto the 12th. Now pluck the 12th fret with a whole and a half bend. Pluck the 12th without any bend, the 10th, and the 11th fret on the G 3 times. Play the 10th fret on the B with a whole bend. Pluck it again and vibrate it. Pluck it without any bend. Hammer the 7th fret onto the 10th, pull it back off to the 7th. Hammer back onto the 10th and pull it back off to the 7th. Hammer the 7th fret on the G onto the 9th and pull back off to the 7th. Pluck the 9th fret on the D, followed by the 7th fret on the G twice. Play the 10th fret on the B with the whole band. Pluck the 10th fret on the high E string, 12th fret B, 10th fret high E string, 12th fret B twice, and then a third time at lower volume as a ghost note. Back to full volume, play the 15th fret with a half bend, release it, pluck the 12th, 15th, 12 twice, 15th fret with a quarter bend, release it, pluck the 12, 15th fret with a half bend, release it, pluck the 12, 15th fret with a quarter bend, release it, hammer the 12th fret onto the 15th, pluck the 12th fret twice. Then pluck it again and immediately follow it with a 12th fret on the high E string and go back to a 12th fret on the B twice. Now pull the 15th fret off to the 12th, pluck the 12th fret twice, immediately follow with a 12th fret on the high E, and pluck the 12th fret on the B twice again. Now the slightest variation, again, pull off the 15th fret to the 12th, pluck this 12th fret once, immediately follow up with a 12th fret on the high E string, and follow up with a 12th fret on the B string twice, which we are now going to be repeating 3 times. Playing the next slightest variation, pulling off a 15th fret with a 12th, and immediately following it with a 12th fret on the high E string, before following it with the 12th fret on the B twice. Repeat this once more. Then pluck the 15th fret, followed by the 12th twice. And then for 14th fret on the G, up a whole step, release it, without plucking it, bend it up a half step again, release it. Bend it up a half step again, release it. Bend it up a whole step, release it, and let this ring out for the rest of the song as it fades out. As this is ringing out at 3 minutes 41, and this bridge is moving into an outro of sorts really, we can hear the left channel play something faintly in the background. For which this is plucking the open G string, and then quickly stopping the note from ringing out. Shortly after, follow it by plucking the open D string, which we let ring out. A few seconds later, 3 minutes 46, we can hear the right channel have some feedback. This is something we can achieve by simply holding the guitar's pickups close to the amp speaker box. We're not playing anything here. again, not something that we necessarily need to slow down here, right, guys?